In this video, we're going to address shadow mapping of the most complicated light type out of the basic three, a point light. As you already know, a point light has a specific position, like the spotlight, but unlike the other two light types, it doesn't have a specific direction. Light is spread all over the place. This presents a problem from a shadow mapping standpoint. Without a direction, where are we going to place the shadow map? The answer, believe it or not, is everywhere. Yep, OpenGL even provides a special texture type which is perfect for this scenario. Enter cube map texture. Oh, and by the way, in this video I'm going to assume, again, that you are familiar with the basics of shadow mapping, so if you haven't already, I highly recommend watching the first video in this short mini-series. You can find the link in the video description below. Okay, cube map textures. This type of texture is actually composed of six separate images. Together, they make up the faces of a cube. Sampling from a cube map is done by shooting a 3D vector out from the center of the cube and hitting one of the cube map texels. Since the cube is basically closed on all directions, this vector has to land somewhere on one of the cube faces. Cube maps are often used to create a skybox, which is a very nice effect that allows you to place the viewer inside of a kind of a 360 degrees image. I still haven't covered skyboxes in my videos, but you can find a tutorial for it on my website. So in addition to a skybox, the cube map can be used to solve the problem of shadow mapping of a point light. Instead of generating a single shadow map for a specific light direction, we will create six shadow maps for the positive and negative X, Y, and Z axes. The shadow pass is going to be executed 6 times instead of just once. On each pass, we set up the camera at the position of the light source, we point it to one of the cube map faces, and we store the distance from the light source to the pixel in the cube map. During the lighting pass, we use the vector from the light source to the pixel in world space in order to sample the distance from the light source to the closest pixel. From this point, the shadow mapping algorithm continues as usual. Since access to the cube map is done using a 3D direction vector, we won't need a second WVP matrix, aka the light WVP, as we did in the lighting pass of the last two tutorials. Let's see how to set up the cube map for shadow mapping. This new shadow map is a bit different from the old one, so I created a new class for it called Shadow Cube Map FBO. The interface is pretty much the same with a couple of exceptions. First, since the shape of the cube map images must be a square, we provide a single parameter called size to serve as both the width and height of the texture. Second, bind for writing now takes a cube face enum as a parameter. We'll see that in a minute. Let's jump to the initialization code. The distance from the light source to the pixel will be stored in the six color textures of the cube map. In addition, we will need a single depth buffer. This depth buffer is going to be reused on each of the shadow passes, so we need just one instead of six. We start the initialization of the Shadow Cube Map FBO class by generating a texture for this depth buffer, binding it to the GLTexture2D target, and calling GLTextImage2D with GLDepthComponent as the internal format and format, and GLFloat as the data type. We also set the usual texture parameters. Next, we generate a handle for the cube map. The cube map itself is created once the handle is bound to the GL texture cube map target. The six images of the cube map are not created automatically, so we need to manually create them. We do this below, but first, let's set up the texture parameters of the cube map. This is pretty standard, but notice that we also set the wrapping mode for the third dimension of the direction vector, which will be used for sampling from the cube map. We can now create the six images for the cube map faces. OpenGL defines a name for each face, and as you can see, their values are consecutive, so this allows us to create the images in a loop by adding the running index to the base value. The cube map stores a single floating point value for the distance, so we use GLR32F for the internal format, GLRed as the format, and GLFloat for the type. And finally, we create a frame buffer object and attach the single depth buffer as a depth attachment. Let's see the changes in the main application code. We start with the shadow pass, where we need to tell the shader where the light is located in the world. This is so that we can calculate the distance from the light to the pixel. Before we clear the cube map, we have to set the clear color to the maximum value of the floating point range. We are storing the distance in the cube map, so by initializing it with the max value, it saves us from various nasty cases where a shadow will be incorrectly detected. FLT max is defined to be, more than I can count. Make sure to include cfloat to get it. Next, we loop over the 6 cube faces. Each iteration starts by binding the corresponding image for writing. At the top of this file, I have a global helper array of structures. The structures contain the OpenGL enum of the cube face and two vectors that help us set the view transformation for rendering into that face. As you can see, the target vector matches the name of the image. Positive x is 100, negative x is -100, and etc. The up vector is 010 for the left, right, front and back images. For the top and bottom images, it is rotated 90 degrees. When we call bindForWriting, we use the corresponding cube map face from the array. bindForWriting binds the shadow map FBO and configures the viewport as usual. Next, it attaches the requested image to the FBO. The second parameter specifies the first color attachment as the target. The third parameter is the enum of the cube face, and the fourth parameter is the handle to the texture, which in this case is the cube map. The last parameter is the MIP level, and it must be 0. In addition, we need to enable writing into the first color attachment by calling glDrawBuffer. Since our single depth buffer is already attached to the FBO, we now have both a depth and color buffer enabled. We clear both of them by calling glClear. Once the current iteration of the loop is complete, the color buffer is fully populated with data. On the next iteration, we switch to a different image and reuse the depth buffer. Next, we initialize a view matrix using the position of the point light. The target and up vectors are taken from the same array. The rest of the loop involves rendering all the objects in the scene. Since we don't know exactly their orientation towards the light and who is standing in front of who, we need to render everything in each pass and let the clipper handle stuff which is outside of view frustum. We now have to talk about the projection matrix. Take a look at the top-down view of the cube map. For each face, we want to render only the stuff which is inside the corresponding triangle. This means that we have to use a perspective projection matrix with a 90 degrees field of view angle. As you can see, this is exactly how the projection matrix of the shadow pass is initialized. Also notice that in addition to the WVP matrix, the shader program of the shadow pass takes the world matrix of the object. And this takes us directly to the vertex shader of the shadow pass. In addition to the standard transformation using the WVP matrix, we also transform the local position of the vertex to world space and pass it on to the fragment shader, which is no longer empty. It calculates the vector from the pixel to the light source in world space and writes out the length of this vector. So we no longer need to mess up with the transformed Z as we did in the last two tutorials. We have the actual distance for the shadow pass. The shadow map is now a color buffer and not a depth buffer, so we have the full range of floating point to store the distance instead of just 0 to 1. Okay, so we are done with the shadow pass, now let's move on to the lighting pass. Before we clear the color buffer, make sure to reset the clear value back to whatever you want the background color to look like. Remember that in the shadow pass, we set it to the maximum floating point value. Next, we bind the cube map for reading. I defined shadow cube map texture unit to be texture unit number 8, but you can use any arrangement that you want. The point is that it has to be different than what we previously used for the shadow map because the types of the samplers in the shader are different. We'll see that in a second. Binding for reading means activating the texture unit and binding the shadow map handle to the GL texture cube map target. There are not a lot of changes in the lighting pass. Since we are sampling from a cube map, we no longer need the WVP matrix from the light point of view. What we do need is the world matrix to transform the vertices from local to world space. We can see this matrix in the vertex shader of the lighting pass, and the transformation is down here. The fragment shader has a new input variable for this world space position. We also need the world space position of the point light. We've been doing our lighting calculations in the local space of the object, but in order to sample from the cube map, we have to get the vector from the light source to the pixel in world space. Access to cube maps is done using a special sampler called Sampler Cube, so we have a new uniform for it. This is why I'm using a different texture unit for the two types of shadow maps. Let's go down to the function CalcPointLight. We calculate the vector from the light source to the pixel in world space. We have a new specialized function to calculate the shadow factor for point lights called CalcShadowFactorPointLight that takes this vector as a parameter. This function starts by flipping the direction of the y vector, and this deserves some explanation. You see, the way that OpenGL defines the axis to the cube map is that we take a 3D vector and we use the component with the largest magnitude to select the face for sampling. The other two components are then used as the UV coordinates of a 2D texture. Let's say, for example, that our 3D vector takes us to the face on the positive Z axis. By the way, note that the coordinate system of cube maps is actually left-handed. In that case, the X and Y are used for the texture coordinates. X is used as U and it goes from left to right on the positive X axis. Y is used as V, but notice that it actually goes from top to bottom along the negative Y axis. This is the opposite of standard 2D textures in OpenGL, and as far as I know, it is done this way for compatibility with DirectX and Pixar's RenderMan package. Our light-to-pixel vector is in world space where Y goes up, so we have to negate it to match what OpenGL is doing under the hood, otherwise we will end up in the wrong location. We can now sample the cube map and get the distance of the closest pixel to the light source on that vector. We compare it to the length of the current vector, and if it is smaller, it means that there is in fact a closer pixel, so we return a small fraction for the shadow. Otherwise, we return 1 for a fully lit pixel. Also notice that we use the same bias as in the previous two tutorials in order to fight the problem of shadow acne. That's it for today's video. In the next one, we will be taking a look at various ways to improve our shadow rendering. Thank you so much for watching, and I hope to see you in the next tutorial.